Subscribe to FanView Live on YouTube for more premium content. And follow G-Sportz on Twitter, G_Sportz with a Z on the end. And follow me on Instagram, _G-Sportz with a Z on the end.
Listen, I'm that boy Fred. Listen, you can also find me on Twitter at @BFredJones. You can also find me on IG at _BFredJones. For more exclusive content, subscribe to all our social media platforms, Facebook, Instagram, YouTube, and Twitter. You can also find FanView Live on Spotify, Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, and Stitcher. Listen, I'm that boy Fred. Listen, you can also find me on Twitter at @BFredJones. You can also find me on IG at _BFredJones. For more exclusive content, subscribe to all our social media platforms, Facebook, Instagram, YouTube, and Twitter. You can also find FanView Live on Spotify, Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, and Stitcher.
Listen up. Your customers, our listeners, could be hearing about your business right now. Yeah, right now. Don't miss out on the opportunity to advertise with NewOrleansTalkNetwork.com. Call our business department today at 504-475-4793 to hear about our great rates. NewOrleansTalkNetwork.com. We provide the people, you provide the business.
FanView Live, new time, 12 p.m. each and every Thursday on the Walls Talk Network. Join me, that boy Fred.
G-Sportz in the building.
Coach Herbert can't hit.
Yeah, I'm woke. Elevate.
Ball game.
Yeah, dig.
Yeah, dig.
You know, I got an old coach who tells me one time when you talk about height, he says, hey, man, listen, when a guy makes a tackle and he makes a tackle for loss, they ain't worried if he's 5'7". You know, they ain't announcing how tall he is, right?
Right.
So those are the kind of things that we look for. You know,
I'm not saying Michael Thomas is this kind of player. I'm just going off of what the reports are saying and the things they say he do. That's something that is a concern for me if he is that kind of person. Because you don't want our number one pick becoming a diva and becoming a cancer already in year one. We need him being taught the right things on how to be a pro and how to be a good teammate and how to be a good person in that building week in and week out.
The Deshaun Watson news has to come down first. And I think...
And we a month away.
Well, you do it. Vegas and... Vegas and...
Whoa, what's up, everybody? FanView Live, Real Fans Talk Sports, New Orleans Talk Network. I'm that boy, Fred.
Coach Hurricane here, back at it again.
Back at it again, and again.
Yeah, dude.
Yeah, dude. This is episode 26 of FanView Live, man. We got so much to get into, so much to talk about. G-Sportz will be arriving, joining us shortly. We got so much to get into today. We got breaking news, baby.
Yes, sir.
Breaking news. We got Brittany. Grinder news. Later on in the show, guys, we're going to be talking a little bit like in AFC North. So who can probably be the breakout quarterback, you know, in terms of the second year? So much to get into. And some of the top five pass rushers in the game of football heading into the season. And we also, guys, people who are tuning in, we're going to have our guest caller, Mr. Marcus Randall, the head coach of Woodlawn head football coach. Will be joining us around 12:15. So we appreciate everybody staying locked in, staying tuned in for that. Also, get locked in on FanView Live, guys. Get locked in on this show. Get locked on this podcast each and every Thursday for 12 p.m. Y'all can find us on Google, Podcast. Y'all can find us on Apple Podcasts. Y'all can find us on YouTube, Facebook Live. Also, IG is FanView Live. Also, on Twitter is FanView Nola. We are here each and every Thursday for 12 o'clock. We got best sports show on the internet. We're going to start this thing off right.
All right.
Coach Hen.
Yo.
What's your case on Brittany? We got the breaking news with Brittany Griner. She's been reported to have 9.5 years in Russia.
Mm-hmm.
Coach Hen, what's your take on the Brittany Griner news? And, you know, does Brittany Griner serve 9.9 years in Russia? Well, what's taking place going on? Or can and could Uncle Joe get a home? What's your position on Brittany?
Well, I think for the fans to know that this is the first domino that had to fall.
Agreed.
This is the first domino that had to fall in order to, you know, negotiate a sign and trade type situation with prisoner swap, because that's what it's like. It's like a sports trade. The person first has to be convicted. You know, has to have a sentence of some sort of, you know, and the main thing about it was, now that this domino has fallen,
correct,
U.S. can now do the negotiations that need to be done, since all quote unquote qualifications have been met that reached this to reach this verdict.
Agreed.
Now, the one thing that I will say that I was super proud of right off the bat was Joe Biden's ability to take the spy off the table and put an arms dealer on the table to swap for Brittany Griner. I know a lot of people like, you know, that make it make sense. Well, here's the thing about making it make sense. You know, you releasing a spy back to his country.
Correct.
You don't, you know what I'm saying, with all the information that he's gotten and all that stuff, you know, that could be a potential deterrent for the U.S. long term, whereas releasing the arms dealer in the type of field that he works in and stuff, you know, you want to kind of remain anonymous.
Anonymous.
Well,
as much as possible.
You know, he's not going to be anonymous no more. So it's like his deal and dealings. And they, you know, here's the thing that nobody knows but Russia and United States. Nobody knows how long we had this guy. So, you know, we could have had him for like 5 years. We'd have had him like for 10+ years. You know, who knows to say that? But the time has changed, and now he's not as big of a threat as it is the spy
being there.
Being released. So, you know, all in all, like, this is a domino that had to fall, and I see it. Who knows how long the process would be? How long the amount of time? Well, not the process. I would say the length of her imprisonment would be determined.
Would be determined
how fast a deal could be brokered. Pretty
correct.
Much.
Now that we have a sentencing for Brittany. Again, this is all part of the deal. Brittany had to plead guilty.
Mm-hmm.
The sentencing had to happen.
Mm-hmm.
Things had to happen before other things can occur. Kind of like with Deshaun Watson. We kind of needed a suspension to happen before the NFL can actually appeal.
Right.
Similar. We needed a sentencing to happen for the negotiations to start to get Brittany back home. And I think there will be a trade that will be made to help Brittany get back on. I don't believe Brittany Griner will serve 9.5 years in Russia. I think America, you know, in the United States, we do have something to offer to get her back home.
Mm-hmm.
But it's up to Uncle Joe. Uncle Joe, your election, your re-election is riding on your negotiation skills. I do ultimately believe that she will get back home. But this is all part of what had to happen, everybody. Like, without a sentencing, you can't negotiate what needs to be and what has to be to make everything happen. This is all part of the game.
And it's part of, the NATO and all that stuff, bylaws, because would you...
Correct.
You know, if you look at the big picture, let's say that 2 weeks late, let's say we made a deal.
Right.
And she's not convicted, you know, and all that stuff. And 2 weeks later, the Russia will publicly state, like, yeah, we found some new findings that determined that Brittany Griner was innocent. Now we just gave up a convicted guilty party for somebody that was quote unquote ruled innocent, even though we know that it wasn't the case. But in the court of public appeal, we just lost, and we lost big time. You know,
in the court of public opinion now, it has become a thing now due to social media.
Right.
It's become this thing now. Now that we have Facebook, we have Twitter, we have TikTok, we have Instagram, and all these social media platforms, the court of public opinion now actually has merit. It has power. It has, you know, movement behind it. I'm gonna tell you right now, Uncle Joe. The LGBT community is looking. They're staring at you, brother. And if you want their vote coming back around, you got to make this work. I do think ultimately this will happen, that Brittany will eventually get home. I think that, like, it's what you alluded to. The sentencing had to happen in order for negotiations to start. It has to be some sort of Simon trade. You know, you get this guy that's going on. Hey, we get this exchange here. And, you know, it's time served. I don't know how the negotiations going to be. But I do know that for this much here, this Brittany Griner case has been a worldwide case. No. And I think that, you know, the spotlight is on America and figure out how we're going to make it. And in addition to understanding that we do have sanctions against Russia going on with oil and what have you. Because of the war. So all these things are war tactics to see if the possibility of what can happen and what can exist. I'm interested in the scene exactly going forward, how this case unfolds.
No, I'm gonna step out the box and say this could be also a win-win for women's sports. What I mean by that is, one, I don't care how you try to spin it. You know, say, hey, you got a United States citizen publicly, not publicly detained, wrongly detained.
Right.
You got this going on. You got that going on. At the end of the day, Russia has different laws than the United States. Every country has different laws than the United States. When you travel, you have to be aware of those laws.
Correct.
That's just what it is. Prime example. If anybody who's been to Canada know that the one thing that you cannot bring into Canada is guns.
Guns.
You can purchase them in Canada, but you cannot bring guns across that border. So what do a lot of people do? Hey, if you, for people who, like, really, really travel to Canada a whole bunch, I've been a couple of times, not enough to be, like...
I'm a consistent visitor.
Yeah, to have this loophole in state for me. But what a lot of people do, they get property in Buffalo, New York, because Buffalo, New York is right...
Right, it's around the corner.
It's like, hey, you draw a rock, you draw somebody, you know what I'm saying? It's a war crime if you hit somebody across Niagara Falls with a rock.
Yeah.
You know,
around the corner.
You know, but what they'll do... They'll get some type of property, some type of lodging or something in Buffalo, leave all their guns and stuff there, travel
across. Sorry for all the Buffalo fans who are Bills fans.
Continue. You know, travel across, and then come back, and they're in total appliance what's going on. If you traveled, we was having this conversation off show with the producers and whatnot. If you could have the baddest chick in the world, you go to any Middle East country, you go to Dubai, anything like that, guess what? She better be covered, because if she ain't covered, she's locked up.
She's locked up.
And which you can't say nothing about it. Now, yeah, the amount of...
they ain't going to accept all that twerking.
The amount of weed oil that Brittany Griner had is less than a stick of bubblegum. I get it. It sounds outrageous and all that stuff, but correct. At the end of the day, that is their law.
That's their law.
So how, you know, Coach Hinn, how does this affect women's sports? I'll tell you how it can affect women's sports. Now you can get, now that, look, one of your polarizing figures is being detained. Now, the way most laws, the way most movements, the way most actions on a global scale happen, you don't know it's a real problem until it's a problem. Now they seem like, hey, this is a problem. First of all, why does an American citizen have to that does something in America have to go overseas to, you know, prolong their earnings?
Their earnings.
Well, this is how. So now that you see this happen, look. Of course, we don't want this to happen again. So now you're going to sit down with the commissioners and say, "Hey, how do we make this happen?" Well, the WNBA has to make more money in order to get things rolling on this.
So women's athletes do not, particularly WNBA, do not have to travel across the country. They can make those earnings here. They can make those earnings in the United States. What now? It could be a win for these ladies because not this is a bad situation, but now the microscope is on the WNBA and saying, you know what? Women's earnings opportunities need to increase. Women's earnings opportunities need to dramatically increase compared to their other counterparts. And people are watching these games. People are participating in these games. Now we don't need these ladies traveling across the country. Mm-hmm. They can stay in the United States and play basketball because she was traveling to play basketball.
Yeah.
Now, if they can stay here, there's no need to have this type of situation going forward and moving forward. So I understand how this could be a win moving forward with the WNBA. This is something that's under a microscope in terms of the new collective bargaining agreement. You know, I think one of the top athletes in terms of WNBA owner earns maybe $200,000 for a season. And so, hey, guys. And so it's one of those things. And so I think the WNBA now also has an opportunity to its other
affiliates
and its players
to move this forward.
To move this forward. So now that other women athletes, particularly WNBA, now can earn more money to where they don't have to travel to other countries to possibly play basketball. They're earning enough money here. They don't have to leave.
Yeah.
So it's kind of one of those things where, you know, it's an opportunity moving forward that the WNBA can probably capitalize on and see towards. That way they can kind of get this thing moving forward. But right now we got to deal with the fact that Uncle Joe need to get a home, baby. Uncle Joe need to get reelected. Uncle Joe need to do something. Now, we start this thing off right.
Again.
My man G-Sportz has finally arrived in the building. Such a long day. It's
always,
August, baby. It's Leo
day.
Season.
Just left the best season.
See, y'all cancers. Give y'all some support and, you know, and all of a sudden.
I support Leo seasonal.
Okay.
I ain't no hater.
All right.
I'm not a hater.
Just checking your pulse. Want to see if your heart beating fast. But listen, guys, everybody who's tuned in, locked in, thank y'all for tuning in, FanView Live. My man G-Sportz has arrived in the building. Now, no further ado, we got our man, Mr. Marcus Randall, for joining us for the second time on FanView Live. For the second time, he's a B-back. Coach Marcus Randall, are you there? Are you on the line with us? Let's see if he can hear us.
Locked in, loaded. What's going on,
fellas? I see the beard growing out, bro. I see you.
I see it.
Yeah, man. You know, it's getting close to that time, man. It's getting close to that season, man. So everything growing. Everything looking good.
I see you. Time, yeah. Got the fresh beard on it.
Got the fresh beard on him. Hey, it's August, man.
It's Leo season.
I'm letting all that show.
Tell him again, Coach. It's Leo season.
Come on. I'm a Pisces.
Oh, Lord.
I ain't going to hate either. You know, I'm like G. I ain't going to hate, though.
As long as y'all have some support for Leo season, we all good.
Coach, man, I appreciate you coming on FanView, man. I know you're getting ready for the season, man. I know y'all got camp going on. And a number of other things. Appreciate you, man. Just talk about the upcoming season, man. You know, you got a lot of the room around Baton Rouge is you got a lot of pressure on you because you got so many studs over there at Woodlawn, man. And you know, you made a deep run last year to the quarterfinals. I know it didn't end like you wanted it to against Destrehan with that questionable 2-point conversion. But we're not gonna get in all of that. But what you expect from your team this season, man? Especially with a you know, a big-time dual-threat quarterback like Ricky Collins, who was one of the best quarterbacks in the country.
Let me address that pressure, first of all. You said we're going to have a lot of pressure. I mean, pressure comes if we didn't have no players. Now, I think that would be the pressure to win. But now, man, we got some guys that came in you know, a great senior class that came in, the first, you know, as freshmen, my first year at Woodlawn. So those guys had a chance to grow with us, you know, in the program. And I'm looking for some great things out of those guys. We got about 32 seniors right now that's part of the program. So we're looking, you know, good and strong. And a lot of these guys have, like you say, been in the system, been in this offense, been in the defense, and been in our strength and conditioning program over the last 4 years. And, man, those guys locked and loaded, came up a little bit short. I know we wanted to make it to that dome run last year. Like you say, we ran into a great Destrehan team and just couldn't pull it out there right there at the end. So we definitely looking to make that. You know, that was our goal this year, too. We definitely want to be in the last game that you could play in of the season, and that's in the dome. So, man, we want to be there, and that's our goal. But obviously, we got to take it 1 week at a time. Man, we got a big schedule here coming up.
So definitely do.
Let's coach. This is your boyfriend. Listen, talking about that schedule, man, we got Southern Lab starting off the season. Talk about this schedule. Talk about some of the things that y'all, you know, you got St. James in this schedule. We got Zachary on this schedule. Coach, let's talk about this schedule, man. Talk about, you know, how Woodlawn is going to shake out when it's all said and done.
We starting off with
U-High. Oh, yeah, U-High. Yeah, you got, yeah, I got. We got a little audio on your end, Coach, but we got a good bit of it. Hey, Coach, we're having some audio issues on IM. I don't know if it's the area that you're in. If you try to reconnect, we could probably get you back in here right quick. Because like, on IM, there's some feedback.
Yeah.
So we can hear you, but it's breaking up real bad on IM. Is there any way you can get reconnected to the Zoom call? There's a bad connection right now. There we go. All right, we're going to get Coach back on the line right quick. See if we can try to get the connection corrected.
Yeah. He's about to start getting into the thick of things with that schedule. They got a tough schedule, man. I mean, last year they had a tough schedule, and I think they got them battle tested, and that's why they made a deep run in the playoffs last year. You know, and I covered that Destrehan game in the quarterfinals, and it came down to the wire. The two-point conversion call that was very questionable at the end, if – they don't overturn that call, Woodlawn might win that game in advance to the semifinals. But, you know, I think that's big-time motivation for Marcus Randall and his staff and the rest of those players. You know, I expect them to make a deep run this year. I mean, I think they have a chance on paper, you know, far as the talent they only have on their team. Right. They have the talent to make a run to the dome. You know, but 5A is just so loaded. I don't know if they came out with the final construction of 5A. Will Carr be in the – 5A with Zachary and Woodlawn, or will they be in the select? I don't think the final.
I think that the LS that might come out like in September.
Yeah, because they did got some appeals going on. Mm-hmm.
So they got to wait out that whole process.
And right.
People who's trying to just stay select or non-select are people correct. Who's like
right.
They're just gonna deal with that.
Right.
I think another thing, G, like to hit on your point, you don't get no more battle tested than playing the state champion. That's somebody that's in a district
yep.
that you like. That's a district opponent. You know, yep. So you gotta keep up with them year in, year out. And somebody that, you know, I think Coach Brew has won like maybe 3 out of the last 5 state championships mm-hmm. in 5A. Mm-hmm. So it's something that, you know, that they're, you know, finally aware of.
And they got a lot coming back too.
Yeah. Yeah. You know. So hopefully we do get Coach Randall back on, because I gotta ask him about the best side of the ball, baby.
Ooh.
Ask him about the best side of the ball.
And hire one of your boys.
Yeah.
Yeah. You know what I'm saying? And I'm interested to get his take on you know, the whole situation with his, you know, the 4-star corner and the 4-star quarterback, Ricky Collins and Jordan Matthews, who, you know, Ricky just decommitted on last week from Purdue. He's been committed to Purdue for over a year. You know, rumors have it that, you know, LSU is supposed to be the school that he's going to commit to in the near future. Jordan Matthews, who, you know, LSU is not on his list, is supposed to come down to Texas and the University of Tennessee. So, you
know, Sarkisian.
Yeah, I'm curious.
Only Henny.
Yeah, and then, you know, they just got the commitment from Derek Williams.
Right.
You know, the 5-star state from Westgate. So, I'm curious to see.
Texas?
You know, yeah.
They got
Derek. And they got Will Randall from Newman. And they got Arch.
Yeah.
So, you know, Sarkisian dipped in Louisiana.
Is in Louisiana,
yeah,
baby.
He didn't dip in Louisiana and got some studs right quick. So, if he get Jordan Matthews, that's just going to be another one. You know, Terry Joseph.
Yeah.
Louisiana native.
Like I said, it ain't Stark.
You know, he's playing a big role into kind of landing these players out of Louisiana. So, I kind of want to get Coach Randall's take on what he think his corner and his quarterback going to do. You know, in the near future with this commitment.
I'm dying to hear it. I'm dying to see exactly what's the case with Woodlawn. Woodlawn's going to make a push. And every year they've gotten better.
Yeah.
You know, they started off
2-9. Nobody talked about Woodlawn football before Marcus Randall got there.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. You know, it was a 2-9, then I think they had then they had the COVID year. Mm-hmm. Then last year they ended up 5-5. You know, so they, every year, they've made progressions, and they were 4-1 district last year.
Then I think his second year, that was the year they went 7-3, and they lost in the second round to East St. John in the mud.
It was the first round.
Nuh-uh.
No, second round. That's right.
Because they played
Jackie Marshall.
Because East St. John played John Everett in the quarters.
Yeah, yeah.
And East St. John beat them. They went to the semi. I think got their head beat in by West Maru.
Yeah.
So that was a really good – that was Ricky's tinkery year.
Yeah.
So – that was a really good year. Last year, you know, I think it went 5-5, the hurricane, and just it was so much. So much going on. So they could never get in the rhythm. By the time they got and then you just jump into that water where you high.
Yeah.
You know, after coming back from the hurricane, good luck with that.
Good luck.
Yeah.
Another thing I wanted to ask Marcus was, you know, he has a partnership with Andy Bryson with Louisiana Magazine. Yep. They've been doing some real great things over the past couple of years and stuff, that we could kind of talk on how it's been impactful for a lot of the guys. For those who don't know, like, they do an all-star game. Like, I've coached it a couple of times. They bring in like kids from all over around the world, and it's been like, I want to say like last year in our all-star game, we had like, I don't know, 70-something kids, mm-hmm. 50 of them got scholarships. Mm-hmm. You know, so like that, you know, that's real big. And one thing I've always respected about Marcus, I know, me and G both know him personally, was the bad rep that he got from the whole Sutton Lab situation.
Whole Sutton Lab situation, yeah.
You know, him and Aaron Sutton, that they didn't do nothing wrong. They got hit with the quote-unquote debt penalty.
Right.
And for him to have to just let that happen, and not, you know, to take it so the kids could keep moving on, and then come back, go to Christian Life, church.
Church Point.
You know what I'm saying? It was Christian Life or Church Point, one or two, but put them back in the playoffs when they wasn't in the playoffs for like at least like a 5 or 8 year stretch.
Then I think he had a stint at Scotlandville with his brother.
With Eric, and then came and they got the Woodlawn job, and it's been, you know, going down.
It's been progress at the progress each year. you know, obviously everybody had to deal with the COVID year, but obviously last year was the first real big step in moving in that right direction. And now, obviously, there's some expectations for this upcoming year over at Woodlawn. Again, like G alluded to, there were no expectations for Woodlawn prior to him showing up.
Hell no. Hell no. Nobody was talking about no Woodlawn football.
No. No one was talking about it. No one was bringing it up. No one was alluding to, man, you know what's going on with Woodlawn. Nah, that wasn't the conversation.
And I'll tell you this, too. If you, like, if you ever been to Woodlawn, if you, and this was people, this was a lot of people who not are from around the area. There's somewhere, Baton Rouge is very prideful about the prestige of sports in Baton Rouge.
Yeah, particularly
and they
football.
Will always, you know, support the old. Like, there's people in Baton Rouge that still talk about Redemptions. Redemptions hasn't been to school since I don't know when.
Right.
You know, so.
We got him back on.
We got Coach Randall back on. Coach Randall, you there?
Here, baby.
Oh, he lying.
There
we go. He crushed him.
Can y'all hear me now?
We hear you
good,
we
baby.
Got you now. Oh, you loud and clear now, baby.
Now, coach, I got to talk about the best side of the ball.
Here he go.
I got to talk
He's
about
so
the
biased.
Best side. Yes, I am biased. You know, me and Marcus have had this conversation in public, you know, plenty of time. You know, you went out and you hired my boy. You know, Coach Benjamin Morgan.
Yep.
You know, coach with him for a couple of years. And, you know, me and him have conversations. How have you seen the kids respond to his coaching styles and his expertise, especially being on the being a defensive back, you know, for the kids to buy in and the transformation that it might help right. y'all program out?
Well, man, first of all, man, he came in. He's doing a great job for us. Man, I'm big on development of it. I know he was a young guy coming in. He had got a little experience as a co-coordinator. And listening to him, not only his coaching style, but his teaching style. And I thought it would just be big for us to get a guy like that into our program. Our guys have responded real, real well to him. And he can actually relate to those guys. Like you say, he's a little bit younger, and he played the game. And those guys are responding to him, and I'm getting excited to see what he's going to do when we actually have to start, you know, preparing for teams, and we start getting game plans together, and having those guys execute over there.
Coach, you got your big time dual threat quarterback in Ricky Collins, who just decommitted for Purdue on last week. You've been committed to Purdue for over a year now. You got your four-star corner and Jordan Matthews, who's, you know, currently uncommitted. You got your kid, your old lineman Brackens, who just committed to Louisiana Tech. Javion Haynes committed to UL. You got some kids that's on their way to playing D1. But the big thing is everybody wants to know what's your take on your big-time quarterback Ricky Collins with him decommitting from Purdue. And what you think is the best situation for him, and as well as Jordan Matthews, you know, with his decision and what he's probably going to do.
Ricky sat down and talked to me right before he decommitted, and we talked about some things that, like you say, he's been committed over a year now. He committed right before last season, right. And we all know right before last season, it was right coming out of COVID. A lot of guys were kind of on the fence if they were going to get offers, how the offer thing was going to go, because all those guys were getting extra years. So he wanted to definitely lock in a place that he felt comfortable with. Coach Biagi had did a great job of recruiting him and making him fall in love with Purdue.
Right.
And I just think, you know, so during the spring, you know, obviously Coach Biagi had left, and he still had a great relationship with Coach Brummer and all those guys over there. But, you know, over the last month, 2 months, you know, I think that he kind of reevaluated, looked at it. Like I said, that was over a year ago, and it's just been a lot of new things coming up. He's able to kind of really see the process now, and I just think it was a great time for him to do it if he was going to do it, because now he got a whole year to kind of assess this thing and truly go through the process.
What about your cornerback Jordan Matthews? I mean, he's kind of been, you know, that under the radar corner that nobody's really been talking about. But, I mean, this kid's 6'2", you know, long arms, have over 20 Power 5 offers. You know, what's your thought process when it comes to him, and what's a good fit for him
on for the next level?
I think anywhere he land. I mean, guys like that come, you know, they don't come, you know, they don't come often. You know, guys that can run with his speed, 10-6, 10-5 guy, long ranges, savvy guy. You know, he's been around football all his life. His dad played on, you know, on the college level, on the NFL level. So he's been getting, you know, brought up in this business. Right. I mean, he's been kind of made for this. Almost, I could look at another Derek Stingley type guy, you know. And I know that you know, he and that family is tight-knitted. So I see this guy being one of those guys that's going to be able to go in and play early at whatever college he go to. I think he's narrowing it down now. Texas, Tennessee, and I think Michigan. Okay. And
Wolverines, baby!
And any three of those right there now at this point is going to fit him. Like I say, he can play anywhere. He can play in any conference, anywhere. And he can also play more than just corner, in my mind, as y'all will see him play a little safety and some of that too this year.
No,
I'm biased. He going to Ann Arbor. Go ahead and make a commitment now. I'm biased, coach. You know, I
think he like to jump, man. I do know he like to jump.
Hey, be the next Jabril Peppers over there, you hear me?
That ain't good.
Indeed.
What you mean? First round pick, good enough? I don't care what he did in the league. Yeah. Handling business at Michigan.
Coach Bellamy doing a good job up there with them DBs, so don't hate, now. Don't hate.
Don't be like that. Anywho.
Yeah. Bellamy has done a great job of recruiting him, too, man. Yep. He did a great job.
Yep. See? And all, maybe just because they care to snow. But listen, Coach, I do want to talk to you. You got a lot of kids coming to your program, and y'all have done some success over the past three or four seasons, not since you've been the head coach. But obviously this NIL thing is starting to become a big deal. What's your conversation now with some of these kids getting recruited in college football, now that the dynamic of recruiting has changed? It's completely different from when you was coming out of high school, decided to go to LSU. The game landscape has now changed with obviously social media. Now we got the NIL to deal with. What are some of your conversations that you're having with some of your kids being recruited, you know, now into college football?
Some of it I was already having, far as the social media piece go, because, I mean, obviously, man, character was always played a big part in getting recruited and, you know, guys knowing who you are. So I always, you know, since social media has became what it became, mm-hmm. I always have those talks with them. Make sure you, before you hit the send, make sure you know this what you want to send, because ain't no coming back from it. Right. Even if you take it down.
Ain't no reason.
Even if you take it down. Yeah, right. And once you get an image out there, you know, and even when you try to change, those things are still pop back up on you. So you got to be mindful. You almost got to have a professional mindset now at this age. And you ask some kids that have all this power and all this at their hands to be responsible with it. But if you don't have adults there kind of guiding them through that, then you know they will have some of those pitfalls. And now when you're talking about NIL, now that's just a whole nother thing on top of that. I don't know all of the ins and outs of it still, as probably nobody all the way knows. But right. I do know this, that you have a chance now to make yourself money going into college, and you don't want to have anything blemishing your name where a company that can, you know, potentially represent you, or a college that wants to be in, but you don't have the right, you know, character, or they don't have the right thing that want to go along with their brand. To be able to give you those, you know, that money that you're getting. But these guys, man, I tell you, unlike when I was there, they getting six figure just to come on in.
Boy, what?
That's big. Hey, you was there Saturday. Yep. I mean, Friday at the BK Splash.
Yep.
I'm just talking to coaches. I'm trying to see how it works. I'm getting more information that I can get. I'm asking questions. They saying almost everybody's starting off getting 50, don't matter if you third string or first string.
Yep. Dang. Yep.
Dang.
So now if you got those kind of things going on, hey man,
is it great?
Do I want to leave school? Do I want to leave college early now?
Right. Right.
No, I want all 5 years.
Yeah.
I want 5 years.
I want that red shirt year and everything.
Well, one thing, I ain't guaranteed to make it to the league, but. Yeah. But if I can stay a fire, and I ain't guaranteed to have a $50,000-$60,000 job when I leave here. So if I'm making it right now, I want all my years. You know?
Capitalize.
Raise your year and all.
So, So I think it's going to set these guys up, if they handle it right, it's going to set them up for when they leave college, no matter if they make it to the NFL or not, they're going to have a pot that they can pull from to, you know, to get their life started with. So I think that is an awesome thing right there. Now, the next thing will be about the taxes, because I know they're going to get taxed. Some people, if they're not learning the financial side of it now, though, so you're going to see some pitfalls there. A lot of guys that don't know understand money. You got guys in the NFL that don't still understand how to use their money, how their money work. Right. And you see guys who are going broke, you know, quickly. So that'll be the education going to be the biggest thing to me, and educating these guys when you're giving them these money, because they're going to probably be on 1099s. So
yep. Correct.
How you going to pay your taxes? How you going to get your stuff paid? And make sure that you don't leave college upside down.
Right. Like Wesley Snipes.
Now,
one of the things that I've always respected about you and your brother Eric, you know, is I think, you know, when God made the Randalls, he might have sprinkled a little bit of like a extra wisdom in the cup, you know, because the one thing that, like, since I met y'all always talk about, man, it's about the kids and setting the kids up. And one thing I've seen since I met you, you know, you transitioned to partner with a good friend of both ours and Andy Bryson with the Louisiana Magazine, and just kind of, you know, out moved your reach more than just Woodlawn and Baton Rouge. Now you're affecting kids from Florida to Texas and everything with the All-Star games and, you know, the gridiron football. You know, how big a deal is that, you know, for you and your family going forward? Because I just think about just like last year All-Star game that we was into, like the guys that y'all put in front of them, like a Pat Williams, like a Michael Clayton, like a Devery Henderson, to see like, hey, there's life outside of football. And, you know, especially for our guys that's from Louisiana, like, these are three Louisiana prospects too that made it at the highest level.
Right.
Well, man, that's a big part. I always knew that I wanted to, I ain't gonna say I always knew, I mean, around about my junior year, I knew I wanted to come back and coach, man. I was getting so much information in college, and I just kind of applied it to, man, if I knew half of the things I knew now coming out of high school, how much further along I would have been when I got to college.
Yep.
So that was kind of like my drive of going back, and I wanted to always come back to Baton Rouge where I grew up at and give it to the kids that's here, because I didn't think we had enough guys. I mean, we got some great coaches, but if you haven't been on certain levels and you haven't had, you know, seen certain things, there's only so much you could give the kid, you know, give that kid. So I definitely want to come back and do that. And I've been here for the last 12 years since I came back from Green Bay, and that's been what I've doing. And now partnering with Andy over there with Gridiron Football, that was just, I mean, I just want to be able to reach all kids, man, reach and help and just be able to do those things on a large scale and be able to promote them and do something, not just coaching and, you know, just be a part of the game in a whole another way. Kind of like you guys doing right now, man. You got to be able to, you know, advance if you're ready for change, and then be ready for the next step, man, you know, and not staying stagnant. I always talk about a book, Who Moved My Cheese? And the book kind of always, you know, kind of tells you about getting already being ready for change before change happens. So, you know, I don't know if I'm a coach forever, so I'm already have this on my belt. I don't know if I want to commentate later, you know, so it's definitely trying to build platforms, you know, so you have those options.
Yep. You got to evolve with the times, definitely.
Agreed.
Marcus, Coach Marcus, man, I want to talk to you about something as it pertains to being an African-American quarterback playing for LSU. The pressure that came with it, And what you went through, and people like, you know, Jordan Jefferson, Rohan Davey, and you know, now, you know, if possible, if it happens, Ricky Collins ends up committing there, he'll be another one. TJ Finley was somebody that came through recently.
Anthony Jennings,
Peter Parrish, even though they
Brandon
didn't stay
Harris.
That, even though they yeah, Brandon Harris, even though they didn't stay that long. And I just remember the scrutiny that comes with being a quarterback at LSU, not just if you're an African-American, but if you're a white quarterback too, but it seems like it's more pressure and more of a bullseye on you if you're an African-American quarterback. What advice would you give to somebody like Ricky or any African-American quarterback that is being the starting quarterback or competing to be a starting quarterback at LSU?
Well, basically, man, you got to go in, you got to be on your stuff, man, at the end of the day. most of the time going in as a black quarterback, no matter where you are, but the first thing they're thinking of as you as an athlete, you know, coming in playing as an athlete. But I think that we have enough examples out there now. Your Russell Wilsons, guys, you know, that played this game and have played it from a cerebral standpoint. So that was my thing going in, knowing the playbook, getting in there, getting the game speed down, and just playing ball. Because if you choose to go there, then you know that the coach there is ready to give you that chance. I wasn't going to LSU, you know, coming out of high school. Jerry DiNardo was the head coach through my high school, all the way up until really right before signing day. And then Nick Saban came in and pretty much on the same thing. I did before myself. I hadn't saw but one black quarterback play there, and that was Herb Tyler.
Right.
Rohan hadn't even played yet.
Right.
And you know, growing up in Baton Rouge and being in Louisiana, you know, you gonna hear your friends talk, hear your people talk around you. Man, they're not gonna play a black quarterback there.
Right.
So, but you know, Saban came in. I trusted in what he told me. Jimbo Fisher, I trusted in what they said. They're gonna play the best player. So if that's the case, and if I'm the best player, and when I go in there, I just got to prove that. So, and they gave me that opportunity. I ended up playing, you know, multiple. You know, I started 8-9 game my sophomore year, rotated junior year, then started, you know, 8-9 game my senior year. So, you got to be under the right coach. I think Brian Kelly is one of those kind of guys that, you know, that's true to his word. And if I think he's going to try to play the best player. You see, he just brought in a transfer quarterback from Arizona State. So,
right.
I think that he just want to win right now. I think, you know, he know he need to win, so he's going to play the best player no matter what. So I don't think color going to have anything to do with it right now.
But when you was at LSU, like, did you have those moments where you kind of got overwhelmed as being a black quarterback at a prominent school like that?
Well, like I said, it never really was about the color. Like you said, I know it down here. We in the South, and it is LSU, so right. Yeah, obviously I'm not gonna be naive to the fact of that, but I gotta say that I never felt that I wasn't playing because of my color.
Right.
You know, even when I didn't play. You know, even when I did have to rotate, right. I never felt like that.
Right.
So,
right.
And it was either I wasn't the guy ready to play, or I was the guy ready to play. And then even when I rotated my senior year, it was with another black quarterback. That was Jamarcus Russell. Again, it wasn't nothing about a race thing. So, But I'm, like I say, I ain't naive to knowing, you know, that does take place. Somebody
right.
would probably want to see certain things go on. So that would be my advice. Just go in, make sure we're ready. And I know you mentioned Ricky Collins. If that's where he goes, being underneath this tutelage and me having it for as many years, I know, you know, a lot of the pitfalls that could come. So he's definitely prepared for all of those things. And just like I told Brian Kelly when he had to talk with him, man, when he come in, he going to know more than the average, you know, freshman coming in gonna know. And he's gonna be and play, you know, more snaps because he's been starting as a freshman 5'8". He's gonna be and play more snap experience and there's no greater teacher than experience.
Yep.
And that's what he do have.
Yep.
See, G-Sportz, LSU is the equal opportunity employee.
I just had to find out.
Listen, man, if you put the dudes in, you're going to play.
I had to find out. Why you got to ask? Why you got to ask?
You know, don't ask, don't question.
Well, that is the stigma. I mean, that is the stigma. If you ask around, that's what people going to tell you.
Right.
And I'm not saying that never happened like that.
Right.
I'm just telling you from my experiences and from what I feel now, talking and meeting and seeing Brian Kelly's process.
Yep.
You
know? Yep.
Man, Mark, you ain't got to explain that to them. They Michigan fans. They ain't never had a black quarterback.
I grew up.
Denard Robinson.
We had two. That's what I'm talking about, man.
I'm saying, but
you know, Greasy. I grew up watching no boys.
Yeah, man.
We had Devin Gardner too.
Yeah.
Braylon Edwards, man.
I'm talking about.
I'm talking about the quarterback position. Y'all had was Denard Robinson.
Tom Brady.
I'm talking about. We talk about black quarterbacks.
Shoelaces, baby.
Tom Brady ain't black. Shoelaces.
No.
Denard Robinson.
And we had Devin Gardner.
I got Denard Robinson. Devin Gardner. Who is that? I ain't seen you in the league. I ain't seen you on that. I'm a Michigan fan.
Big time hater.
Hey, now, Mark, I got to, because we talk about LSU and everybody know I'm the LSU guy. I got to just ask you a question real quick.
Go ahead with the last question.
I got to ask you a question. Bluegrass miracle or the pass that Joe Burrow drew in the SC championship game when he was running toward the sideline, you know, and pulled out of like three tackles and drew a touchdown. I mean, drew a first down on 3rd and 15. Which one was a bigger play?
man. You know, the touchdown got to be the biggest.
The bluegrass nigga get Kentucky, man. The flip-flop and the flip-flop and the all of a sudden Landon Devery hit us in hand and he scored.
Man, hey, I got to say, that play won an ESPY. Yeah. So I
can't that one. You know? Never put Devery on the map.
Marcus, I won't know.
Nah, you would say Joe Burrow's 2019 season, that was a...
Can't nobody compete with that.
Then look, that's why I had to ask, because like I'm a diehard LSU fan. You know what I'm saying? Like since Jared DiNardo, like you said, up into where we are now. And it's been some spectacular plays, but like when I tell people like, hey man, I think the Bluegrass Miracle is probably the play that put LSU on the map. Because think about it, like we had, like you just mentioned, you had Herb Tyler, you had Cecil Collins, you know, you had Rondell Mealy,
Kevin Folk,
and then you know Kevin Folk. You had great players, but it never was like a great enough team and great enough moments. And I felt like that was the moment that kind of put like everybody got to see. You know, then like, cause after that play, you got to see the Jamarcus Marshall, Jamarcus Russell, out.
Early Doucette.
Yeah, you know what I'm saying.
Early Doucette against Auburn. Man, I can go plays on.
You know what I'm saying? Like him against Brady Quinn, who was quote unquote supposed to be the first the first overall draft pick. You know, outdueling them in the Sugar Bowl.
Yeah.
You know, to the
Jeff Samardzija was still tearing y'all up.
You know,
dude.
So to the Leonard Fournette. You know, so I feel like that.
I'll tell you the play. I'll tell you one of my plays that I think changed the whole culture of LSU football.
Here we go. I was trying to pull the story out, y'all.
We got Georgia at home. My junior year, 2003. Mm-hmm. Now Matt Mock rolling out to the left.
Yeah.
You see Skylar Green actually breaks the play off and goes into scramble drill. He hits him deep in our right by our tunnel. Touchdown against Georgia. And that was one of the staple wins that kind of put us over the hump as being one of those nationally ranked teams that people have to worry about him. And we went on to win it all that year.
Yeah,
I was Higgins alum. G-Sportz. Green.
I was trying to pull it out because when you told us when you and Mike, because you it was crazy because you and Michael Clayton both had the same exact story. Like, hey, this is kind of what changed the guard. Like, because that Georgia team was loaded. You know that Georgia team was loaded,
and we started all this off for y'all with Josh Reed putting everybody on skates. Running routes.
Hey, Josh Reed don't get enough credit.
Josh Reed don't get enough credit because
he ain't looked the part. That's why.
Hey, Josh Reed was that guy. That was special, man.
That's the guy that started all this. Him and Rohan Davis.
Because he was
Rohan Davis. I will say that. I mean, that's another one. Him and Rohan Davis. Us beating Tennessee in the SEC championship.
Yeah.
In the SEC championship that year, man. That's another one. You know that
it started everything.
He changed the coach. Yeah, started everything. Started everything. Say that
because he was one of the first outside of I can't think of his name right now. The guy that won the first Heisman at LSU, but he was like one of the
Billy Cannon.
I couldn't think of his name. But Josh Reed winning the Ballista call was like that's the cream of the crop, and you didn't have LSU players. You had you always had first team All Americans, first team All SEC, and all that. But you never had the guy that went to say I'm the best in college football at this, and that kind of started the run of the great LSU Fighting Tigers.
Well, like I tell and I tell my guys, and I would tell anybody, if you're not winning, it's gonna be hard to get any of those big time awards like that. You know, because I mean, even though they individual awards, they kind of team awards.
Yep.
But if you're not winning, you don't get those. And that's just how they go. And you're gonna see, and then once you start winning, and you can start seeing people like Ben Wilkerson now start winning the O-line award. You got Glenn Dawson started being probably the most decorated guy in LSU history. Start getting those big-time awards that's out there. So when you start having success as winning teams, then you obviously start jumping up and your guys start getting recognized more for those big-time honors.
No doubt.
No doubt, man. Sheesh.
Coach Marcus, man, I appreciate you coming on a fan view, man. We got to get you back on in the near future.
Yeah, man. You know, I want to come sit next to y'all.
Hey, Marcus, now, every time I offer you and Andy both to come down, like, you know, y'all got to pull out the big Rolodex, the portfolio, man. No, you know what I'm saying? We're in prime time, y'all, man.
I'm in there, man. Right there at the BK space, say, man, Thursday, you on? I say, I'm on there, man. I'm in the building.
Listen, we setting up the show to where that's gonna be all possible.
Yes. We actually changing the platform. We're in the process of changing the platform. We about to change it to like a pivot and I'm at League podcast.
There it is.
It's coming.
We'll be having real conversations.
It's coming.
Man, bring me back through, man. Hey, man. Bring me. Man, I want to be it's first.
Coming. That's what I'm talking about.
It's coming.
But look, you know I'm going to be on the sideline for many of y'all games this season. Can't wait to see how it's going to all turn out, man. Good luck to y'all this season, Coach.
All right, man. Y'all have a blessed day,
bro. You have a good one, Coach.
All right.
The great LSU Marcus Randall, baby.
Marcus Randall. Listen, in high school, he was incredible.
Man, what?
He was incredible in high school.
Man, in the Baton Rouge area, when I tell people the top three that I just felt like was like you didn't want problems, Marcus, he's the only quarterback because the other two are running backs. Marcus Randall, mm-hmm. Warwick Dunn, Jeremy Hill. You didn't want those problems. You didn't want those problems. Jeremy Hill, that redemption was ridiculous.
I believe Marcus Randall at Glen Oaks was ridiculous. I believe if Nick Saban had been at LSU 2 years prior to Marcus coming into LSU, like if he had already like
been there,
set the tone and set the staple down in the program, I think Marcus Randall is probably a second, third round draft pick. But when he came in, Saban was just coming from Michigan State. Trying to put his stamp on, you know, he wasn't saving yet. You know what I'm saying? He was still trying to figure some things out.
Jimbo.
Also, you know, another thing too.
Jimbo still was young in the game.
Marcus was like, a lot of people.
He also had Obo on the defense. What's his name?
Will Muschamp.
Yeah, but that was a hell of a staff.
Bo Pelini, Will Muschamp, Carl Dunbar.
Yeah.
Hey, I know my people, baby. But like I said, they had started up Derek Dooley.
Dooley was on that staff?
Yeah.
So was.
He was my recruiter.
So was.
He was my recruiter. I mean, I know tight ends coach.
Yep.
So was.
You know, you had
people, staff, dog.
You had people forget it was a young Lane Kiffin. You had a young Kirby Smart. You had a young I can't think of his name.
That was the days.
You know what I'm saying? You had two other people that GA that wind up becoming, mm-hmm. you know, coaches. But who was I talking about?
Marcus Randall.
Marcus Randall. He was the second Nick Saban recruit to sign. The first was Dorsett Buckles, mm-hmm. out of AME. Marcus Randall was the second one, and the third one, I want to say it was Chad Lavallee. I'm not 100% sure, but I know for
Chad
sure.
Lavallee
like
was big time.
I know for sure he hit. Boom, boom, boom.
He another one that don't get talked about enough. Chad Lavallee was dominant.
I think the reason why. Is because when he went to the league, he just but it was one of those like we kind of like if you understood the trenches, like hey, he's great at this
because don't try to make him do all this,
yeah,
right.
And then he went when you get to the league, you got to do all this, right. And that was like if it was just running straight, like you couldn't run lead on Chad Lavallee.
Chad Lavallee was one of those first D linemen at LSU.
And he was a pretty boy.
And he was light-skinned, baby.
Pretty boy.
You know what I'm saying? He had the little LaRon Landry little fro curl with the fresh lining all the time.
He was a nasty pretty boy.
You know what I'm saying? It was like, but then when you also have motherfuckers like Glenn Dorsey and all that stuff that come right behind you.
Tyson
Kyle
Jackson,
Williams.
Brockers and Sam Montgomery.
It was like, that's when LSU was that. But the
Kyle
great,
Williams.
It's the great Carl Dunbar, man. The great. It's the reason why he's been coaching for the Steelers for forever. Every time he retired, they bring him back in. You know what I'm saying? Carl Dunbar is phenomenal.
Throw another zero behind.
Yeah. You know what I'm saying? Like, Carl Dunbar is phenomenal. Like, because, like, people forget that before LSU was DBU, they was D-line you. Like, they was sitting
still putting them D-linemen on.
You know what I'm saying? But, like, it was because, like, every year it was a first-round draft pick. I think Arden Key was, like, the last one.
Arden Key was the third-round pick.
Mingo was a six overall to the Browns. You know what I'm saying? But he shouldn't have went that high. And I'm gonna let you guys.
He had a lot of upside though.
Yeah, but it was like his at an SEC program, like he showed you like how much weight he could put on. And it's not like he's playing receivers. I mean, he's playing in the trenches.
A lot of guys
and LSU didn't get outside of pass rushing. You know,
a lot of guys don't get Chad. You know, Chad Lavallee don't get a lot of credit. Trev Falk, the linebacker position, don't get a lot of credit.
It's because Trev
Ali Highsmith.
Trev left like
Calvin Shepard.
Calvin Shepard. Yep. you keep going. Brady like
Kevin
Minter. I think the things that helped Brady James out, honestly, he went play for the Cowboys. Yeah. If he doesn't go play for that high profile of a team,
Marcus Spears as a D lineman, who's a former first round pick,
but look who he went play for.
Cowboys.
You know what I'm saying? Like,
Marcus Spears is one of the best athletes to come through Louisiana. Yeah. When you talk about football and basketball.
Yeah. Marquise Hill.
Unfortunately, he passed.
But, you know what I'm saying? We understand why he's not. So one of the person that he just named, Ben Wilkerson. He doesn't play a sexy position in center, but like he was the first person ever
55
under Saban to come in and play as a freshman.
He should have got drafted, man. That's the problem. He should have got picked. You know, Ben Wilkerson should have got drafted.
You know, I'm biased about that.
But
he's part of the turnover culture to that made LSU what LSU is, what it is today.
Yeah,
he's one of the best D linemen, especially centers that they've had. Ben Wilkerson, he should have got picked. They being biased over there, but it's all good. But moving on, we got some more FanView Live to get into, y'all guys. We got to get into this. Let's see what we're gonna get into, y'all.
Please don't come on no disrespectful list today.
Listen,
just don't do it. Just don't do it.
First of all, let's discuss the AFC North.
Go ahead.
Who wins the division? Obviously, we have the Bengals, who are your runner-up at the Super Bowl champions. We have the Browns, who are full of distractions. We have the Ravens, who have a quarterback contract dispute. And then we have the Steelers, who have the same regime, but we have a quarterback battle. Who wins the North this year coming up?
You said it right when you started announcing the teams. I think you might have put them in order. Honestly, it's the Bengals. It's not even close to me. Simply because I look at what the Ravens done. I didn't see them get better. I watched the Bengals get better and better by far. You know, they made it to the Super Bowl and was one play away from, you know, one drive away. One drive away from winning the Super Bowl with the worst offensive line in the league. You know, they did nothing but upgrade that. You look at the Ravens, they lost what's the receiver they drafted that was hurt?
Lasher?
Yeah.
Tylan Wallace?
No, the speed.
Bateman? Rashad Bateman.
He lost Hollywood Brown, who had the most chemistry with Lamar Jackson.
Still got Mark Andrews.
You also lost Hayden Hurst, who was his kind of like his safety blanket. You know all your running backs that's on roster are coming back off an injury. The defense, you know, kind of static. You just trust. I think the Ravens and the Steelers, you kind of put us in the same category because you trust John Harbaugh. You know, you trust you're going to get a quality product out of that. You trust you're going to get a quality product out of Mike Tomlin. The Browns, on the other hand, especially with the NFL appeal and what's going on right now, you got Jacoby Brissett. Without, you know, no disrespect to Jacoby Brissett, he's not going to get you. Even as talented as this roster is, he's not going to get you over that hump. Without a move being made, I said them and the Steelers are going to be fighting for last place. That's just
G-Sportz. Who wins the North?
I think y'all being very disrespectful to the Ravens. All right? You got an MVP caliber player like Lamar Jackson who is going to be motivated this year to prove everybody that he is not just a runner, but he can throw the ball from the pocket.
Can he get his contract resolved?
They're going to pay the man. They're going to pay him. On the offensive side of the ball, listen, they haven't had a ton of weapons since he's been there. And they've always been an 11-10 win team since Lamar Jackson has gotten there, right? And he won the MVP doing it, all right? I think Rashad Bateman, you know, takes that next step this year. I think he's a better complete receiver than Hollywood Brown. I think Hollywood Brown was just a one-trick pony. You know, you talk about somebody like Tylan Wallace, who they drafted, I think, in the second or the third round from Oklahoma State last year, who was, you know, not a speedster, but can catch the ball, can high point, and can get separation. I really like what Tylan Wallace brings to the table. And then we talk about somebody like Mark Andrews, who's one of the better tight ends in the league, who is his safety valve, is going to be, you know, one of his best playmakers on his team. And then he has a really, really good offensive line. I think even though J.K. Dobbins is coming off injury, he got hurt early in the season last year.
Right.
I think he got hurt, like, what, week one? Week two?
Yeah, one.
Yeah.
Because they had three consecutive weeks where they lost somebody.
Then they lost Latavius Murray. They lost a lot of guys.
Yeah, so I could see J.K. Dobbins coming back 100% and being a really, really good running back. And on the defensive side of the ball, that's where they're going to make their money at. All right? This defense is really, really good. You know, you talk about somebody like Pierce in the middle with big Calais Campbell. You know, Patrick Queen in the middle, who I think is one of the better upcoming Mike linebackers in the league who can run. LSU. And you talk about that secondary with Marcus Peters. Well,
unfortunately, obviously, with the passing of Jalen Ferguson, obviously somebody who can help that defense out of big time. That's a big loss for them.
Yep. Mm. You know, I like Marcus Peters and Kyle Fuller at the corners. They drafted Kyle Hamilton from Notre Dame. I think the way they're going to use him on defense, he's going to flourish. And then they took Marcus Williams from us, who's whether you like it or not, he's one of the best ball-hawking free safeties in the league. I think he's going to add more turnovers for that defense. And then let's not forget about Marlon Humphrey, who is a top seven, top eight corner in the league, who can shut down one side of the field. So they're gonna win their games on playing defense and Lamar Jackson being an MVP-caliber player. So I think this division goes through the Baltimore Ravens. Will it be easy? No. I think they will split with the Bengals, but I think they're going to have more consistency throughout the season than the Bengals, and I see them winning the division.
I got to pick the Bengals. And the reason why I got to pick them is because they reassured up their offensive line. I think they have one of the best receiving corps in football, and I think they obviously, like y'all alluded to on the previous episode, that Joe Burrow is probably most people's MVP candidate for the year. Mm-hmm. And when you have a guy who's going to probably be your MVP candidate, if he could put up similar numbers to what he did last year, he could duplicate those things, he arguably might be your MVP. And the Bengals, to me, arguably might have the best record when it's all said and done, pending health, in the AFC. I don't discredit what you said about Baltimore. Obviously, you get Kyle Hamilton out of Notre Dame. You get Marcus Williams. We know what Marlon Humphreys can do. Patrick Queen, you know, has played up to me. Jalen Ferguson, losing him this year, is they got to find a way to replace that. Then they lost out on free agency with the guy, one of the Smith brothers that they was supposed to get in there, but he ended up getting to Minnesota. Mm-hmm. So that those are things I'm going to show about. Obviously, the receiver core is question marks. Miles, I think Boykin, who they got, I know they named several years ago, has not produced.
Right.
Obviously, Hollywood Brown's not in the Cardinals uniform. Mark Andrews is going to be Mark Andrews. He's the best red zone tight end you can ask for in football. He's a red zone magnet for Lamar Jackson. But Baltimore had to clean up the distractions. They got to get this figured out with Lamar Jackson and get him in camp. And, you know, obviously I don't think he needs camp like much other quarterbacks, but just the distractions. Get rid of it. Get this done. Get this move. When you look at the Bengals, they're going into camp with no distractions. We know who the weapons are.
We know
who the team is.
When I look at the Bengals.
They need to reassure them. And plus, I'll get into it later, but that D-line ain't going to be bad. You got to block them dudes over there.
When I look at the Bengals, though, their defense is a bend but don't break defense.
True.
And I just think that if Joe Burrow and that offense is not scoring 27, 28 points a game.
Who's going to stop them?
I'm just saying. If they're not scoring 27, 28 points a game, can you rely on your defense?
Absolutely
I don't know
not.
About that. The Ravens, if their offense ain't hitting on all cylinders, they can rely on their defense.
They got some.
And last year, they was top seven. They had a top seven defense in the league. And you add somebody like Marcus Williams and Kyle Hamilton to the fold, along with all those other pieces they got in place, I just think the Ravens – you know, especially when you got somebody like Harbaugh who's been in the game longer than Zach Taylor.
Right.
The Bengals got to show that they wasn't a one-hit wonder. They got to prove that.
True.
They got to prove that.
True.
And that defense is going to have to get better than it was last year. The film is out. I'm just saying.
So ain't nobody going to pick the Steelers? Nobody like the quarterback? Nah, they got going up there?
Who picking Trubisky?
Hated it.
Hey, what's the worst high school you could think of, G?
Higgins.
Stop it.
So disrespectful.
Stop it.
So disrespectful.
Higgins. Stop it.
We won more games than like y'all last year. H.L. Bourgeois won more games than Higgins last year.
For the first time ever.
Ever?
Ever.
Ever?
Ever, ever.
Stop.
Ever,
stop.
Ever. And we was an all-girl school.
You
want
to put money on it?
We was an all-girl school.
You want to put money on it?
Didn't y'all go,
do you want to put money on
it? Did y'all go like 0 and something 1 year?
My junior year.
Couldn't win a game.
Couldn't win a game. But talk about it in basketball.
And
we were top three in the state.
And look, that 0-10 HL Bourgeois team wouldn't take goddamn Mitchell Trubisky.
I told y'all Mitchell Trubisky is mediocre. I don't have nothing y'all saying. You was over here to my one at one point in time.
The fresh Matt Nagy went to your, going to your brain.
Figure some things out. Boy, Trubisky is bad. But, you know, to their credit, to Pittsburgh's credit, they got a solid receiving core. No tight end.
No quarterback. Stop.
Yeah, that's not a – you know, I was trying to give
Devin
him a fight.
Devin Bush is struggling.
Health. Health is an issue. Health is an issue.
Devin Bush is struggling.
That is health. He still plays sideline. I don't know what time to do over there. But Bengals, Ravens. Anybody will get the Browns a shot?
Not a shot.
How? There you go.
How, Sway? Listen. All right, guys. Listen. We're moving on. Let's talk some of these top pass rushers in the game. Who are some of y'all top five pass rushers coming to the game?
Let's hit a disrespect. Let's go.
Y'all go.
Let's hit a disrespect.
Let me start this off.
Go ahead. Do your thing.
Fifth,
Sway.
I'm going to pick Trey Hendrickson. He ended the season with the Saints at 13 sacks. He goes to the Bengals, and he gets 14 sacks. I got him coming in at fifth. Max Crosby with the Las Vegas Raiders. First of all, led the league in most pass hurries against all players. All players. So he's coming in at fourth. Three, Nick Bosa. One of the best pass rushers we have in football. Number two is Myles Garrett. Number one, TJ Watt. TJ Watt led the league in led the league in sacks with 22.5. He tied with Strahan. That's the top five. Who your five is?
Go ahead, Hen.
Go ahead, G.
Go ahead, Hen. I gotta digest that shit.
Go ahead, Hen.
Go ahead, G.
This man said Max Crosby.
That motherfucker top said five. The white top boy.
Five, man. It is for this shit.
Go ahead, G.
Max Crosby.
Red.
What's wrong, Max Crosby?
Your birthday coming up on. The older you get, the worse you get.
What's wrong, Max Crosby?
Hey, good player. He really said Max Crosby.
Top five?
He really said Max Crosby. G, go with your line. Number five, number four, so it can shake me back. Number five.
Ooh, he said Max Crosby. I'm gonna go with Khalil Mack. Only reason I'm going with Khalil Mack at number five is because of the injuries, and he has taken a step back over the last year and a half. All right, last year he only had three sacks. He dealt with a lot of injuries. Maybe him being in a new environment with the Chargers, on the other side of Joey Bosa, he might be able to have some kind of resurgence. But you still can't disrespect Khalil Mack and not put him in the top five because you know what he's capable of. I think he's going to be rejuvenated and ready to be a dominant force again. So he's at number five for me. Number four. Michael Parsons. I know he's a well linebacker, but from what Dan O'Quinn said, he wants to line him up at defensive end to be a pass rusher majority of the time, depending on how Anthony Barr does in training camp. If Anthony Barr does what he's supposed to do and can show some kind of resemblance of how he looked a couple years ago, Michael Parsons will be lining up with his hand in the dirt for a lot of the time. And if that happens, I see him having 15-plus sacks. I mean, he had 13 sacks last year. He only played with his hand in the dirt, like, 60% of the time. So I got Michael Parsons at number four. He could possibly be number one if he really lined up there 98 to 100% of the time. Number three, Myles Garrett. Myles Garrett is a freak of nature. You know, this kid here, you can chip him. You can double team him. He going to still make an impact on the game, and he will have double-digit sacks no matter what. He don't even need somebody on the opposite side of him. He just that kind of freak of a nature.
Correct.
So Myles Garrett definitely got to be in your top five. You can arguably say he's number one. But I got him at number three because I don't think he's going to be better than these top two people that I got for this upcoming season. Number two.
Because I wait for something off the wall to come out your mouth.
Nick Bosa. I really like him. I think Nick Bosa has a chance to rejuvenate his career again. I know he had 16 sacks last year, but
unblockable.
Yeah, but last year I just feel like he had majority of those sacks at the beginning of the season. Toward the tail end, he kind of started fizzling out. So I don't know. I don't know if that was injuries. I don't know if, you know, the way they was using him. But you know when you line him up one-on-one, he's gonna win his matchup more often than not. So I got Nick Bosa at number two. Number one, T.J. Watt. I mean, if you don't have T.J. Watt number one, I mean, yeah, but he led everybody. He led the whole damn league.
22.5, baby.
With 22 sacks. I mean, you just can't block him. The motor is impeccable. His length, his strength. I mean, when you see a white boy that could have power and speed, you better run for the hills. And that's what T.J. Watt is. He has a combination of power and speed. I don't care if you got Lamar Jackson. It don't matter. You could bring Michael Vick out of retirement and put him back in his prime. He can run him down because he takes really good angles. T.J. Watt got to be number one. That has definitely the best top five of us three.
Oh, my God. The disrespect. Your turn.
Now, to get down to the technical side of what's going on.
Go ahead, because this your position, babe.
Yeah. Yeah.
Go ahead.
So
school your boy.
It's not going to be Max Crosby. I tell you that damn much.
Unblocked.
So my list, you know, is you know, because just like
hers is not sex.
Just like how G was like looked like the quarterback position are totally different than everybody else because he played it. I'm going to look at the D-line position. Numbers is great, too, but I also understand situational stuff. So here it goes. Number five, you got to go with the ageless one, Von Miller. Von Miller has a plethora of moves at his disposal. Mm-hmm. Everywhere he goes, he's only – like this is the third team he'll be on. And he's going to be in a environment where he can be in one-on-one situations. And it's still at his age. Nobody can block him one-on-one. The spin move is still deadly. The long arm, the stab and go, the club and rip, he has it all. It's the reason why he runs his own elite pass rushing camp, and he steals other stuff. The move that he stole from Aaron Donald was phenomenal. So
the jump and swim?
Yeah, the jump and swim, especially coming for somebody as athletic as Vine, who could dip and rip, you know, from that angle, you still got to deal with speed and power. That's just ridiculous.
See, the Bills love him. Paid him a lot of money.
Ridiculous. Number four, you got to go with Trey Henderson. Henderson, you know, what he learned from Cam Jordan, what he learned from Cam Jordan, and if you look at the snaps from the Bengals in the playoffs all season, when he wasn't on the field, they really didn't have a shot at hell. You know, you brought time for the DBs, and it was like his motor. He's probably like I put him like third on the all motor list for guys in the league. But Trey Henderson, like the willingness to bend the end. He's probably one of the best at it in the league right now, you know, with the strength and the stuff that he learned from Cam Jordan is phenomenal. Number three. Now, I wanted to put Michael Parsons on here. I wanted to. But with the uncertainty if he's going to play there or not, I can't.
It's question mark.
Conscience, up to Anthony Barr.
You know what I'm saying? Put him there.
But it ain't up to him.
But I'm going to put Nick Bosa right here. Put Nick Bosa right here.
Agreed on something, man. Number two.
Y'all know how, you know what I'm saying? Like,
my number three.
Look, the thing about his brother Joey, I think Joey is more talented, but Joey is a more balanced guy.
I think Nick has a higher motor to get to.
That's what I'm about to say. Joey doesn't play at full. Like, he takes plays off a lot. Nick doesn't give a damn.
No, he don't care.
Doesn't give a damn. Now, one of the big reasons, I think, like G alluded to, his 16 sacks, like, out of his 16 sacks,
14 of them came in the first half, and then down the stretch, he didn't have a solo sack. It was more the .5 deal. When Eric Armstead got hurt, it changed. You know, it changed a lot of stuff.
They focused on him.
You know what I'm saying? It did. You know, they asked him to do. They asked him to kind of do the role that Armstead was doing to kind of let Fred Warner keep eating. So it changed the scheme up a big deal.
Yeah.
Number two is going to shock a lot of people, but I just got to say it. I'm going to put T.J. Watt right here.
Who?
Mainly why. This is why I put my disclaimer out the numbers deal earlier. 16.5 of his sacks came when he lined up on the same side as Stephon Tuitt. Stephon Tuitt is a monster in his own right.
One of the best D linemen in football.
You know what I'm saying? And he collapses everything. Cameron Haywood got a whole – all his sacks when T.J. Watt was on the same side of Stephon Tuitt. It's a big game changer. What that means is out of the 22, 16 came from him lining up right there. So the other 6.5 came from him being opposite of Tuitt. You know that's I can't put you number one with. You know, because your scheme, like, hey, your situation is with all these guys. Your situation. But that's a big advantage.
Right.
Number one, I put Miles Garrett there simply because it's not nobody else on that front seven that helps him, that can help him in that type of way. But he's still a force that you have to reckon with. The only problem that I have with Miles Garrett, without him being clear cut number one, he doesn't have a big enough toolbox for the athlete that he is. He's a bull rusher. He's fucking phenomenal with speed. Mm-hmm. He's long as hell, but he doesn't have a counter move yet. And to say he's going into year seven without a deadly counter move, you know, Cam Jordan has a fucking phenomenal counter move. He's not as fast as Miles Garrett. He's as strong, but he's not as fast as Miles Garrett. But
as athletic either.
Yeah, when you turn on the film, and the first person you see is Miles Garrett. Miles Garrett has the best get off in the league, and it's not even close.
Then
you got a better get off than Vine.
Simply because,
I'm talking about strictly get off.
Yeah, simply because like he delivers more force from the ground because Miles Garrett plays with both hands in the ground. Vine is like 50-50. You know, Khalil Mack learned it the easy way. Like, hey, when he first got to Chicago, when they put him at the end, he stopped standing up as much. And when he started coming like off from the 3-point or 4-point stance, like that's like a sprinter in track and field. It just builds that much more power. And he's been doing it. Von Miller has a hell of a. That's saying something that he doesn't come out of a stance. But
Miles Garrett. Situation, he's never played with another dominant pass rusher.
You played with Clowney, weren't you?
Yeah,
with Clowney. But I'm saying, like, when you look at Von Miller, he had a DeMarcus Ware
to maybe learn something from him.
You start looking at some guys, he's never had that in Cleveland.
Yeah, that's a big part. That's why I remember, like, and I admit I was wrong. I was like, man, when Trey Henderson signed to the Bengals, I was like. They paid him a lot of money. I don't know if that's a good move simply because he was going opposite of Cam Jordan. We knew, like, you was going to get the one-on-ones. In the league, you're supposed to win one-on-ones. That at any position, you're supposed to win one-on-ones, especially when everything is taking your eye the opposite way. He proved it, and then you see the technique. Like, all right, well, all the stuff that you learn from, he's more athletic than Cam. And
right
so all of, and he and, it, and I don't even I wouldn't say I don't know if he's more athletic than Cam, but hell, he's a whole lot younger than Cam. So the stuff that Cam used to do when he first got in, he can't do as much. That's why you see Cam kind of stand up now to kind of use his strength more to his advantage. It's just like if Marcus Davenport would stay healthy, Marcus Davenport would be the best D lineman on the damn team. It's not even close. That's what it is. The fact that Miles Garrett has put up double digit sacks each year and outside of one season had Clowney. That says something.
That says something.
You know, that front seven of Pittsburgh will always be elite because that's just the Pittsburgh culture.
Correct.
So that's why I put Myles Garrett, you know, as number one. Like I said, it's like, and I get it if you go by numbers and all that stuff, cause that pick. But you know, to me, like to somebody who like actually watches what you know, like I studied this stuff. I studied it to teach my guys and all that stuff. Even my former players that come back to work out, I touch. If this is what the guys do in the league, I want you to put on a best show in front of somebody. You know that's evaluating from a league point of view. So I'm a teacher type of stuff. Like it's just the technique part of it is Max Crosby. If you talk about run stopping ends, I say hell yeah. He's just effort. It's no technique. It's no technique. Nothing.
It's all effort with him. But what I love about him is that he led the league in most rushes in the league. He had 101, and I think the next closest guy was at 80. It wasn't even close. Now, granted, he can't, you know, obviously he had 8 sacks. But, when you watch his effort as a pass rusher,
to me,
man, you got to block this.
That's the difference. That's the difference.
Man, you got to block this.
You would take hurries. Like, hurries is a great number from a defensive tackle. Their job is to push the pocket. Their job is not to bring the goddamn ends. Their job is to close that shit. You supposed to if you can't if you get back there 100 or something times and you only get 8, that's a bad ratio.
So I got a question for you.
For me or
you? 39, game on the line, last drive of the game, you get a stop, we win the game.
Mm-hmm.
Who you taking to come off the edge? TJ Watt or Myles Garrett? Just 39, I need to get a sack. Strip sack, fumble. I need something to happen.
I gotta go with TJ.
Let me ask you this. Who is with what?
Who with him?
Yeah.
What you mean?
Like I'm saying, like if you tell
where me his team is constructed right now.
I would take TJ Watt simply because you got like it's not they're not gonna put him in that 1-on-1 situation. Whereas Myles Garrett, he's going TJ Watt's going to get a 1-on-1 because they're going to stack him. Like, if that's the situation, he's going to get stacked behind or put right with Stephon to it. So, he's going to not – that's a winning combination. Myles Garrett's situation, hey, they can afford to keep the back end right here. They can go – they can bring a tight end in to kind of flex to kind of give you that because nobody else is a threat for them on the defense line. But if you're talking about, hey, the game is going, like, you know, if you're talking about, like, hey – that same situation, no timeouts, no, you know what I'm saying, we on the field and going, like, and it's, you can't sit there and adjust to what's going on. You got to call the play because, you know, you don't have timeout. The clock is running down. I'm taking Myles Garrett. But if you're talking about coming out of a timeout, like, based on, the, like, that's why I asked, like, you know, who's with him. Based on the way they constructed, TJ Watt has more in his situation that he could take to advantage. It's nobody on that Cleveland defense on the front end that you could say, he's going to help. Now, you got people on the back end. You can say, hey, Denzel Ward, go to the number one guy. Walk down. You can play around with some stuff to make the quarterback hold it a little longer for him. But up front, it's nothing that's going to help him right now win that battle. But that's a hell of a question, though. That's a hell of a question because I don't think people look at it in that type of situation. I don't think people because if we would have took the word edge out of it, I would tell you.
Oh yeah, it's
Aaron Donald.
It's Aaron Donald.
I would say look, another person who's close to this list, but I need to see how it's gonna work for him for the Raiders would be Chandler Jones. Chandler Jones, I think he's that fringe 6'7" guy, but depending on like we seen him in a kind of odd front most of his career, and now he's going to like a kind of three, like a four line with his hand in the ground. How is are you going to put him in linebacker? Or are you going to put him with his hand in the ground and like let it be like a hybrid front?
So that's I know he's going to be probably playing with his hands in the ground, actually on the D line where he's used to playing that coming from New England and even playing it here in Arizona. There's kind of been like a 3-4 scheme where he's kind of playing like kind of like what TJ Watt has done. This is going to be a little different. So that's why I ain't having my top pocket. The way he's going to be lining up is going to be different.
And,
if he can still get 15, 16 sacks.
I honestly think him leaving Arizona might be a bad move because the team was so constructed well from with Buda Baker, Byron Murphy. You know, you had speed all around to where, like, the ball was going to be hell. But, like, hey, you know.
It's the Raiders. Well, listen, moving on. I want to get into this last part of the show here. I want to talk about the quarterbacks that got drafted last year. Who's going to probably have a breakout year this year? Obviously, we had some first-round picks. We had Mac Jones. We had Trevor Lawrence. We had Zach Wilson. We've had Justin Fields. Trey Lance. Davis Mills. Ended up getting a starting job over there in Houston. You know, not a former
first-round pick.
But which one of these quarterbacks that's going to be in their second year, who's headed for a breakout year? Because this quarterback thing, the second year has been a lot of cases for a lot of guys. So who's headed for that breakout year this year, their second year?
I mean, there's no question that it's Trey Lance. When you talk about somebody that's in a good situation, Trey Lance is in the best situation out of all the second-year quarterbacks. You with Kyle Shanahan, who was probably the best play caller in the league, depending on who you're talking to, some people might say Sean McVay. And then you got the weapons at his disposal with George Kittle, Brandon Ayuk, Deebo Samuel, hopefully Devontavian Martin from the Tribe Paris, baby, make that final 53. I think that he is best set up to have a breakout year. Even though I think Justin Fields is the best second-year quarterback out of all of them, he's just in a terrible situation.
Well, now you finally starting to get it.
If
I told you this last year.
If his agent is smart, he is forcing a trade. He has to get out of there. I mean, that is one of the worst situations for all the quarterbacks. That's even worse than what Zach Wilson is in with the New York Jets. So, I just think out of all the quarterbacks, Trey Lance is the most set up out of all of them, man. I mean, it ain't even close. I mean, I guess you could say Mac Jones, even though I'm not really a Mac Jones fan. I don't believe in him. But, you know, Belichick is going to put him in situations to win and be successful. But Trey Lance, hands down.
I got to agree. Trey Lance is in the best situation out of all the guys. You have the best, you know, always be one of the best head coaches in football. You look at some of the receiving weapons, the tight end weapon, not just that, but the ability to run the football with Elijah Mitchell. You already know in the Kyle Shanahan system that you're going to be able to run the football.
Really good offensive line.
Yeah. So Trey Lance is walking into a situation no different from what Patrick Mahomes walked into behind Alex Smith. This is looking very identical with this story. And so – when you look at the arsenal that he has coming into this year with the head coach that's there, I got to give it to Trey Lance. I don't even want to talk about Houston because that's a disaster down there. The quarterback situation, he has nobody to throw the ball to, and I don't have that much faith in Davis Mills. I got to agree with you. Justin Fields is in the worst situation among any starting quarterback in terms of what's around him, the weapons. It's atrocious, and you have a quarterback, and you hide this defensive-minded coach. I don't know what the Bears are thinking. Zach Wilson. Obviously, they draft, Garrett Wilson, who, to me, has these Santonio Holmes vibes. I think he has that kind of ability in terms of a wide receiver. Obviously, they still got Corey Davis, who they brought in from the Titans, who really hasn't panned out that much. They don't really have a tight end. But if Zach Wilson probably be the second best one, I think he could have a breakout year. Mac Jones, there's no receivers there in New England. We don't know who called the plays. You know, obviously. We don't know. You got Patricia this week, and you're going to have Joe Judge next week. No one knows who's calling the plays in New England. I can't do it. Okay? Now, Doug Peterson is in Jacksonville, but obviously that Jacksonville had some disarray last year, and you get Travis Etienne this year back. James Robinson has had a sophomore slump. We don't know what he's going to go into this third year. And Christian Kirk is your best offensive wide receiver throwing the football to. I don't know how successful, you know, Sunshine is going to be down there in Jacksonville. So I would have to say Trey Lance has the best opportunity, had the best breakout year possibly. And I'm not trying to put him in any MVP conversations, but a lot of these second-year quarterbacks, depending on the situation, has made some MVP noise.
I think Trey Lance has a chance to be a top 10 quarterback this year.
Me, personally, with the Trey Lance situation, I know he's in the best situation out of everybody. It's not even a question. I've seen this story before with a phenomenal play caller in Jim Harbaugh. Was it Jim or John? Jim Harbaugh, a phenomenal offensive line, a dominant tight end in Vernon Davis, a phenomenal run game, and a changing quarterback in Colin Kaepernick. I seen him before. Yeah, like it got him to
Super Bowl.
The Super Bowl statistic numbers was it Great. All that great. So I would break it down like this. I think who have the best win, the most wins, would be Trey Lance. it's not even a question about that. The better numbers, however, I'm speaking like purely passing, simply because of this barometer. I think it might be Sunshine, simply because like I want to say Zach Wilson, but because that offensive line has done tremendous, you know, like they you know, Elijah Vera Tucker, Mekhi Becton is slimming down, looking phenomenal. They don't have a run game, so like it's gonna be like more of get the ball out and all that stuff. But they have a defensive-minded head coach, and Rob Saleh was like, "Hey, pipe that shit down."
Right.
But on the flip side of it, I look at somebody like Doug Peterson. You have Marvin Jones, you have Christian Kirk, you have Travis Etienne, and a dumpster fire of the situation that Sunshine was in last year with the Urban Meyer. He's your coach 1 week, he's not your coach the next week. you know, you don't know who your strength coach is, now you know who your strength coach. Like, it was just in total disarray, and it seemed like at the time, like, he was the only adult in the organization.
Man wanted to go back to Clemson.
You know, just coming in. But, like, with all that going now, and you real deal have an offensive-minded guy who's had success, who, like, hey, this is an opportunity to get back in the league, and, you know, he's going to come out. Like, he was a phenomenal play caller, you know, because he was an offensive coordinator for a long time before he took over after
after Andy Reid left.
That was Chip Kelly.
You talking about Doug Peterson?
Yeah, he took over after Chip Kelly.
It was not San Fran. He took it by Andy Reid.
No, we're talking about Philly, huh?
Yeah. It was Andy Reid, Chip Kelly.
Well, he took over Chip Kelly.
He took over. And then, you know, and we seen what he done with Nick Foles. But also, like, he had Carson Wentz
looking like an MVP,
you know, before he got hurt. You know, so you get somebody who's a more polished quarterback who is athletic enough to run, but of course you're not gonna wanna run the franchise as much in a different system. I see him having better statistical numbers, though it might not equate for much in wins because of the division that they're in. But I see him having a better statistical year out of all the second-year quarterbacks. Two, I think, eliminate themselves because of the defensive-minded head coach, and they did nothing to help their young stars in the Jets. Outside where the Jets did get Garrett Wilson and stuff, but I don't even know who the play caller will be for Justin Fields. And had the Texans, you know, Lovie Smith, you know, they just trying to get by.
Yeah.
They're just trying to get by. They bake it.
They'll have a top five draft.
That's what I'm saying. They baking everything on these next upcoming drafts to move the barometer of what's going on. And then also, like y'all just said, I think the Patriot way is kind of going to hinder Matt Jones for us. Statistics-wise, they're going to win. They're probably going to be the second highest win total team out of the second-year quarterbacks. But, you know, you lost Josh McDaniels.
Yeah. Joe Judge, Matt Patricia next
But then
week.
Also, I just look around, you got Hunter Henry. You got Jonnu Smith. I can't think of a wide receiver that you have.
You didn't let DeKal Harry go.
Yeah, you know what I'm saying? But he wasn't. You know, performing like they thought.
We don't know who the receivers are, and those two tight ends really didn't have a great.
Well, Jonnu Smith got that big payday and went crazy and didn't.
Out of Tennessee.
So to answer your question, I think the best win numbers will be Trey Lance. The best statistical numbers will be Sunshine.
Sunshine.
Poor Justin Fields.
Yes.
Let me ask y'all this before we close out. Knowing the situation that Justin Fields in, but also knowing what's up and coming in the draft, if you're losing, I want to say, let me put it, if you're in that 9 to 12, I would say 9 to 12. You're in that three-pick range where your team is headed right now. Mm-hmm. Would you, A, be willing to sit and wait for what's coming out of college, or would you try to get Justin Fields And if you are going to try to get Justin Fields, what are you willing to give up to get Justin Fields?
You got to ask yourself, what kind of team are you and what kind of quarterback you have there?
I'd be willing to give up a lot for him.
I'm going to tell you like this. If I'm a team like the Philadelphia Eagles, I have no faith in Jalen Hurts.
We're going to see this year.
That's my position. Even
though you got A.J. Brown with him now.
Care what
So you say if you're Philly, you're trading.
I'll be trying to get Fields. Fields is a better quarterback.
But you don't know how Jalen Hurts is going to do in his second year. You don't know.
That's true.
You don't know.
We don't know.
You don't know. We don't know. You got to let it play out.
Who would you rather have? Fields or Hurts?
I got to see how Hurts going to play this year. I got to see how he going to play.
Who would you rather have?
I got to see how Hurts going to play this year.
Who would you rather have?
I got to see how Hurts going to play.
I'm going to be honest with you. I'll tell you the team who should be at the dope. Be at the dope. The Giants.
And the Houston Texans.
Yeah.
For Justin, I wouldn't want him to go
to Houston.
I wouldn't want him to go to Houston.
It's just as bad.
I wouldn't want to go to Houston. The only upside going to it's two upsides going to Houston. One,
Tampa
no,
Bay.
Two, no, no, one, no, no state taxes. Two, you in the dome.
Tampa Bay.
But then you know they
Pittsburgh.
You know Tampa Bay really loves Kyle Trash. They really love him. And then also, you know, this is not Arians. You know, I'm just telling you, like, Byron Leftwich loves him. Byron Leftwich.
I bet you if you ask him off record, he's going to say, I love him, but I love him more. How about that?
Listen, that man like Kyle Trash. Kyle Trash looked he had a solid senior
season. He all right.
He
ain't no world beater.
You know Pittsburgh can't do it.
Why they can't?
They drafted Kenny Pickett.
So?
In the first round.
So?
You know, I'm saying they can't do it.
So?
They can't do it. I'm telling you, New York Giants should be hot shit.
I'm going to be honest with you. Let me tell you who really should be calling. All jokes aside.
You better not say it.
The Falcons.
No. They just drafted
Ritter.
Who cares? So?
Not what I just said about Kenny Pickett. You talking about what?
So? You want Desmond Ritter or Justin Fields?
Justin Fields.
All right, then. You want Marcus Mariota or Justin Fields?
Justin Fields.
All right, then. Guess who should be calling?
The Giants. The fucking Giants.
Daniel Jones. Boy, the Giants. Daniel Jones, the worst. Listen.
I'm saying you make that deal because, like, it helped. To me, I just think about Justin Fields still on his rookie deal. So, it's like the money and all that stuff. You could give up the draft picks and all that stuff. You got somebody. Think of the head coach you got. You got McAdoo. Look what he did with Josh Allen.
Look at Arthur Smith. Arthur Smith could do a lot with –
Arthur Smith does a lot in the run game.
He do a lot for this kid.
In the run game.
He did a good job with Tannehill.
Throw it right there. I'm just going to put one wide receiver.
Tannehill threw for over 4,000 yards.
Yeah. With Jonnu Schmidt and all them. Hey, come here. Come play with these young people.
The day of the Geechee is over.
it's like that old.
Poor boy time.
It's like that old Southern Baptist church. The doors of New York is open. Will you come?
Boy, they ain't gonna listen. They got a first round pick who probably won't play a snap last year.
Hey, before we go, I wanna say this though. I love the way Trevor Penning is looking in training camp. He started his fourth fight yesterday. He got kicked out of practice. I love it. Look like we having Kyle Turley 2.0. We gonna be nasty.
I love it.
I can't wait.
I love it.
Can't wait. Trevor Penning, keep doing your thing. Keep doing your thing, Trevor Penning.
Nick step to the right.
Peyton Turner looking like he about to have a good year. We about to look like we got some help.
Or he going to have a lot of holy penitences.
You keep looking at Trevor Pennington. It's about to be a fight night. Hit him with a left. Hit him with a right. Keep fucking with Pennington. It's fight night.
Yeah. Listen, I love it. I love everything about it.
Big boy. It's a big boy.
Yeah, hey, he is.
I told y'all, man.
Told me what?
Told you.
Told me what?
I liked him, too. Yeah, you didn't want him right. You didn't want him at the first pick. You want him at our first round pick.
You're right. I still wanted him.
Yeah.
It don't matter when. I want it.
Got it.
Yeah.
If I want a chick at 3 o'clock and you want her at 8 o'clock in the morning, what's the difference? I still want it, though.
But if I got her first.
I ain't opposed to sloppy seconds.
Hey, and I ain't supposed to hand out dirts, baby. Sit her back.
That's our show, guys. FanView Live, real fan.
Pass the peas like you used to. Pass it.
Every Thursday, 12 p.m.
Pass the peas.
New Orleans Talk Network. Y'all can pass it out back FanView again. Live page. Subscribe to our Facebook page.
Send her again. Again. And again.
And I'm going to send her to Fred.
Yeah.
It's your birthday.
And he going to put bleach on it, and I'm going to get her right back again.
Yeah. It's Leo season, baby. You did. Y'all subscribe to FanView Live each and every Thursday. Facebook, YouTube, IG, Twitter. Don't forget to subscribe to our podcast on Spotify, Google Podcasts, App Podcasts. We're all over the page, baby. It's Leo season. We'll see y'all next Thursday. Football time.
Listen up. Your customers, our listeners, could be hearing about your business right now. Yeah, right now. Don't miss out on the opportunity to advertise with NewOrleansTalkNetwork.com. Call our business department today at 504-475-4793 to hear about our great rates. NewOrleansTalkNetwork.com. We provide the people, you provide the business.
FanView Live, new time, 12 p.m. each and every Thursday on the Woodlawn Talk Network. Join me, that boy Fred.
G-Sportz in the building.
Coach Herbert can't hit.
Yeah, I'm woke. Elevate.
Ball game.
Yeah, dig.
Subscribe to FanView Live on YouTube for more premium content. And follow G-Sportz on Twitter, G_Sportz with a Z on the end. And follow me on Instagram, _G-Sportz with a Z on the end.
Listen, I'm that boy Fred. Listen, you can also find me on Twitter at BFredJones. You can also find me on IG.